Hi there. In this video, you are going to see some applications of the cross product and the dot product of vectors in three-dimensional space. First, you have to remember the geometric effects you know about the dot product. Two vectors u and v are perpendicular if their dot product equals zero, and the other way around, if the dot product of two vectors equals zero, then they are orthogonal. You know this also follows from the fact that the dot product of u and v equals the length of u times the length of v times the cosine of the angle formed by u and v, okay? Now you also have to remember a geometric fact about the cross product. If you form a parallelogram by the vectors u and v, you can compute its area by taking the length of the cross product of u and v. Let's take a closer look at the figure on the slide. You can compute the area of the parallelogram by transforming the parallelogram into a rectangle like this. As you see, the height of the triangle cut off from the left-hand side equals the length of v times the sine of the angle alpha. This means that the area of the rectangle, length times height of course, equals the length of u times the length of v times the sine of alpha. But what if v is a scalar multiple of u? What is the area of the parallelogram spanned by u and v? In this situation, alpha equals zero, and so the sine of alpha is also zero. So the area is zero, and zero is the norm of the zero vector. This implies that the cross product of two such vectors equals the zero vector. Well, this is of course trivial if you think about it. The parallelogram spanned by two vectors, which are scalar multiples of each other, is a line, which clearly has area zero. But now you have also seen a way to determine whether two vectors are collinear by computing their cross product. You have seen a cube before, at least in real life in the form of a die, I guess. Typical for a cube is that its angles are all right angles and that it has six square faces. Let's now look at a more general three-dimensional object whose sides are six parallelograms. This is called a parallelepiped. You can construct it by using only three vectors. Let's do this. Take the three-dimensional vectors u, v and w and construct u plus v, u plus w, v plus w and u plus v plus w. The body you then get is a parallelepiped. Of course, if you take the parallelepiped spanned by the standard basis vectors I, j and k, you get the unit cube as your object. Now there is an elegant way to compute the volume of a parallelepiped. It uses both the dot product and the cross product of vectors. Here it is. The volume of the parallelepiped spanned by u, v and w is given by the absolute value of the inner product of u with the outer product of v and w. Let's compute this for our example with u equals minus 1, 0, 0, v equals 0, 2, 0 and w equals 0, 1, 2. Following the Amsterdam method, you find that the outer product of v and w equals the vector 4, 0, 0. As you can see, the outcomes follow the right-hand rule from v to v, w. Taking the dot product of this vector with u gives minus 4. So you found that the volume of the parallelepiped is the absolute value of this, thus 4. Check for yourself that the order of the vectors u, v and w in this formula may be interchanged without changing the outcome, as long as you use all three of them once. An application in physics of the cross product is torque. Let's look at the force F acting on a rigid body at a point with position vector r. For instance, apply a force to a wrench in order to tighten a bolt. The torque tau is defined as the vector describing the tendency of the body to rotate around the origin. The only component of F that can cause a rotation is the one perpendicular to R, that is the component with length sine of alpha times the magnitude of F. The direction of the torque indicates the axis of rotation. Have fun with the exercises!